This is a sordid story of child sex abuse, money, parental neglect, and a disturbed woman who may have killed three people, including her own brother. She married John Creighton and had a daughter, called Ruth. Mary Frances Creighton was born on July 29, 1899, in New Jersey. Mary's problem was that she just could not accept that having got away with murder twice, she could not get away with it a third time. In 1933, short of money, Mary hit on the bright idea of poisoning her brother Raymond as a means of inheriting his legacy and claiming his life insurance as well. And although it became known to the court during her subsequent trial that she had indeed purchased arsenic, no one actually saw her administer it to Raymond, so the jury acquitted her. Mary was obviously overwhelmed by her success, for within a short space of time her father and mother-in-law both died, the postmortems revealing traces of arsenic, but this time, because the quantity in her mother-in-law's body was not considered by the jury to be sufficiently lethal, the case was thrown out. And probably because the authorities assumed that the same amount of poison would be found present in the body of the dead woman's husband and so be similarly rejected by a jury, they decided not to waste the court's time in bringing further charges. Despite his parents having been poisoned and the finger of blame having pointed at his wife, John Creighton did not leave Mary. Instead, they moved to Long Island with their young daughter Ruth, where they became friendly with another couple, Everett and Ada Applegate, who after some time moved in with them. Allegations were later to be made, not only that Everett seduced 15-year-old Ruth Creighton and wanted to marry her, but that Ruth and Everett were having an affair. Whether either of these was the motive or not, sufficient to say that Mary reached for the poison bottle labeled Rough on Rats, and little by little supplemented Ada's eggnogs with its contents until Everett found he had become a widower. This time, however, Mary's phenomenal luck had run out. Charged with murder, she stood trial and not only confessed to the crime, but also accused Applegate of actually helping to administer the poison. After 3 hours deliberation by the jury, both were found guilty and sentenced to death. The day before she died, Mary Frances converted to the Catholic religion and was baptized by the prison chaplain, Father McCaffrey. She was asked if she wanted to say anything to the public. She wiped the tears from her eyes and spoke these words, "I have done many wrong things, but I know God will forgive me. I was a good wife and mother, and whatever I did for him and the children. I hope they will have a better life than I did." In the condemned cell in Sing Sing prison, Mary gave a few signs of despair. On the contrary, she was obviously buoyed up at the prospect of a favorable result being reached by the Court of Appeal. But when news came through that the original death sentence had been affirmed, her nerves gave way completely. Eating little but ice cream, she lay on the bed in her cell crying and moaning. She rarely slept, but when she did, she would wake up screaming, "I can't stand it. I can't stand it." What further exacerbated her already fragile mental condition was that while she was thus incarcerated, no fewer than 10 men were electrocuted for their crimes within the prison. Events that could not possibly be kept concealed from the other inmates. The strain on her emotions was such that 2 days before she was due to be escorted to the execution chamber, she became bedridden and hardly able to move. A special commission was authorized to examine her both physically and mentally, its results stating, We find no evidence of organic disease of the central nervous system or the body as a whole. Mrs. Creighton is well-developed, well-nourished and muscular. If she has lost weight, it is not apparent. Her disturbances in motor power, in sensation and in speech are in part hysterical. They are grossly exaggerated by conscious malingering. Her mind appears to be clear, and she fully appreciates her present position. She is suffering from a type of disability which would improve rapidly if she were encouraged, and get worse if she were discouraged. Her condition is the reaction to the situation in which she finds herself. Mary and Everett Applegate were both executed by electrocution at Sing Sing Prison in New York on July 16, 1936. The executioner was Robert G. Elliott, not only an expert in his profession, but also noted for his humane and compassionate attitude towards his victims. When on the 16th of July 1936 he reported to the prison, he was shocked to find Mrs. Creighton in a state of total collapse. Clad only in a pink nightdress and black dressing gown, wearing black slippers and holding a rosary, she was placed in a wheelchair. The first time a victim had ever been transported in that manner on such an occasion, and in the execution chamber was lifted into the electric chair. Limp and interesting, her eyes closed and all the color drained from her face. She was obviously unconscious, and the warders had no difficulty in strapping her into the chair and attaching the electrodes. After checking that all necessary connections had been made, Mr. Elliott gently raised her head and, pressing it back against the rubber headrest, secured it in position. To block the view of the helpless woman from would-be photographers among the official witnesses in the audience, the guards placed themselves between the chair and the observation window. And as soon as they did so, the executioner moved swiftly to throw the switch, and Mary Frances Creighton died without even knowing. As an indication of the heat that is generated in a person being electrocuted, one of the warders on duty that night suffered severe burns on coming into contact with Mrs. Creighton's body while releasing her from the chair. Normally this would have been prevented by the thick clothing usually worn by the victim, but on this occasion her flimsy apparel proved inadequate. The next person to be executed for the crime was Everett Applegate. The odor of seared flesh still clung to the execution chamber when Everett Applegate, walking tall and ramrod straight, came to meet his doom. "Gentlemen," he said to the 23 witnesses, "I want to say something. Before God, gentlemen, I'm absolutely innocent of this crime, and I hope the good God will have mercy on the soul of Martin W. Littleton." A few moments later, he was, as he predicted, sent to his final home. Thank you for watching Death Row.